The Qin Dynasty is an interesting part of Chinese history. The dynasty doesn't last long, but aspects of it can be seen in China to this day. There's a lot of history to talk about, so I decided to break up the video into multiple sections. First will be a case study on the Terracotta Warriors, a historical site that is a great introduction to the Qin Dynasty. Next will be the dynasty itself, from China's first emperor to the events that followed after his reign. So let's jump in, starting with the Terracotta Warriors. In March of 1974, in the dry Shaanxi province, three farmers were drilling holes in the ground in hopes of finding water to dig wells. Instead, they found shards of ancient pottery. News of their discovery spread, and in July, a team of Chinese archaeologists started excavating. What was uncovered shocked the world: an army of life-sized terracotta soldiers. These soldiers were buried near Qin Shi Huang, who declared himself as the first emperor of China from 221 to 210 BC. For the last four decades, archaeologists have discovered around 600 pits across an area of 22 square miles. They are a series of underground vaults, and most have not been excavated. Since the site was easily accessible, a museum was built around the site and opened in 1979. In the trench-like pits stand long columns of clay soldiers, horses, and chariots. There was an estimated 2,000 soldiers uncovered at this point in time, but there were supposedly 6,000 to 8,000 soldiers buried with the emperor. More on the soldiers themselves. The material used to make the terracotta warriors and horses was yellow earth, which was found around the burial sites. This material is not hard to find, and was a great material based on its bonding and molding capabilities. The clay was filtered of unwanted contaminants until it was pure. White grit containing sand, quartz, mica, and feldspar was added. This grit strengthened the clay and made it easier to shape. When it comes to making the soldiers, it can be simplified into several main steps. First would be making the torso, which would start from the square foot plate, moving upwards to the legs, and ending at the collar. This part of the process was made in an assembly-like fashion. Next was making the arms, hands, and head. The hollow arms that were made straight were put into single molds, while bent arms were put into multiple molds, divided at the elbow and glued together. The hands followed the same process as the straight arms. These pieces were then dried in the shade. After, the arms were attached to the torso, followed by the hands. The head could be considered the most challenging piece to shape. The process first starts by molding the front and back sides of the head. This didn't have to be perfect, as once the front and back pieces were glued together, several layers of mud were added to create unique facial shapes. By manipulating the face through carving, pasting, scraping, and etc., no two terracotta warriors were the same. After the figures were done being shaped, they would be fired in kilns. The ancient artisans were experts of their craft. In order to keep the figures evenly heated, they made small holes in suitable locations throughout the figure. The figures were then heated at around 1,000 degrees Celsius, or 1,830 Fahrenheit. Upon many studies conducted by experts, they found that the figures were most likely placed upside down during the firing process. This is because the upper body of the figures were heavier. This shows that the ancient Chinese deeply understood the concept of center of gravity. Lastly is the glazing and coloring process. In April of 1999, excavators found six kneeling armored warriors that still had parts of color left. This shows that the terracotta warriors were all painted to look like the real deal. Now that we learned a bit about the terracotta warriors, the next step would be to look at who the warriors were dedicated to: the first emperor of China. Ying Jin, who would later declare himself as Qin Shi Huang, was born in 259 BC. This period was a time of war, as just 75 years ago, in 334 BC, there were seven warring states: the Qin, Chu, Wei, Han, Qi, Yan, and Zhou states. Ying Jin started his rule over the Qin state in 246 BC, when he was just 13 years old. As he was just a boy, his ruling court prepared the Qin state for conquest. Some time passed. Ying Jin, now in his early 20s, sought guidance from an influential statesman named Li Si. It is quite possible that Li Si was the one that started many of Ying Jin's accomplishments, but that is still up for debate. Ying Jin established a uniform script. This script allowed people of different dialects to communicate with one another. Yingxian introduced standardization, a distinct feature of the Qin state. This was also applied to weapons, making them easier to replace parts. An example will be making simple parts for a repeating crossbow. Yingxian created an advanced agricultural infrastructure, which used irrigation canals and storage granaries. By 230 BC, Yingxian was in full control of his military and readied for battle. The conquest of the Qin state took place from 230 to 221 BC. The Han state was conquered first in 230 BC. In 228 BC, Qin occupied part of Chou. In 226 BC, the Yan capital was under Qin control. In 225 BC, the state of Wei was conquered. In 223 BC, the state of Chu was conquered. In 222 BC, Yan and the Chou states were fully conquered. And in 221 BC, the Qin state conquered the state of Qi. With all warring states conquered, China was unified under the Qin dynasty. That same year, Yingxian proclaimed himself as Qin Shi Huang, which is translated as First Emperor of Qin. After Qin Shi Huang unified China, he built canals and a road network that likely passed 4,000 miles, or 6,437 kilometers. The roads included 40-foot-wide speedways, with a central lane only reserved for the royal family. Under the emperor's rule, China's currency weights and measures were standardized. On China's northern border, the feared nomadic Huns were a constant threat. They would normally invade southern farmers for loot. In order to protect his people and his land, he ordered 300,000 soldiers to attack. Under the command of General Meng Tian, unfortunately, the Huns were not stopped, so a great military defense was built, known today as the Great Wall of China. However, parts of the wall still existed before the Qin dynasty. We would have to go back to the Zhou dynasty, the pre-warring states period from 770 to 221 BC. The walls in this period were a means of preventing invasion from other Chinese states. In the Qin dynasty, the emperor repurposed the existing walls from the past and linked them together for a strong defense. This, of course, was extremely effective. Now that I've talked about some of the emperor's great accomplishments, let's look at some of the problems that arose under his rule as emperor of China. Qin Shi Huang adopted legalism as the official philosophy of the Qin dynasty. With this idea came many problems for the common people. So what is legalism exactly? Legalism was the philosophical belief that human beings were more likely to do bad because they were motivated by their own greed. This philosophy was advanced by Han Feiza from 280 to 233 BC. Han looked to older writings from a Qin statesman, Shang Yang. Shang, who first came up with this state policy. His form of legalism dealt with everyday problems, with a focus on how one should behave in a time of war. Shang Yang is also credited with the tactics of total war, which made it possible for the Qin state to defeat the six warring states in the first place. That is to say, two influential figures supported the idea of legalism. Li Si would be the third. When legalism was implemented early on in the Qin dynasty, the government was a collective which sought to reduce the power of the aristocracy, which they eventually did. In this political system, morals were not seen as important to the legalist philosophers. They thought it had no part to play in an individual's decision. As to them, all human beings are motivated to do wrong. That is why legalism was tried by creating extremely strict laws to control the population of China. To put it in perspective, if an individual did not follow the rules, the people in the town or village had the collective responsibility to report the person's wrongdoings. If they refused to do so, they could all be locked up, or worse, beheaded. People that contributed the most were rewarded, but those that did very little were considered useless and sent to work as slaves in the emperor's major building projects, like the Great Wall and the Great Roadway. Around this time, there were many different philosophies that believed the exact opposite of legalism. Philosophies such as Confucianism, which stressed the importance that people should try to find good within them, was a threat to legalism, as they can't allow the people to question their government's authority. This was a huge blow to education, as Qin Shi Huang's legalism had it heavily suppressed, to the point literacy was denied to the majority of the population. A clear tactic can be seen, that is to keep the population uneducated, so they are much easier to control. This policy also resulted in the mass burning of books from all forms of religions and knowledge not deemed suitable for the people. In 212 BC, the emperor had scholars rounded up and executed en masse. This was under the guidance of Li Si, his chief advisor. The history of the Qin dynasty, legalism, and the epics of Qin Shi Huang were rewritten, while other books were banned outright. Luckily, the next dynasty, the Han dynasty, recovered the books that were well hidden and restored them, bringing literacy back to the people. Overall, the emperor's form of legalism was hated by the population of its time, but it still was effective of creating a powerful state. In 210 BC, the first emperor, Qin Shi Huang, died at the age of 49 while he was on a journey throughout the kingdom. The emperor's trips were thought to be thorough inspections of the empire, but later evidence seems to suggest that the emperor was looking for the elixir of immortality. It turns out in the later part of the emperor's life, he became interested in death and had hopes to be immortal. You could say it became an obsession, as some scholars at the time thought his search for immortality was pointless. It is said the emperor would never sleep in the same room of his palace for two nights in a row because he was in constant fear of being assassinated. He ordered the construction of the Terracotta Warriors and his tomb early in his reign, but that was most likely a display of power. It is not known how China's first emperor died, but that didn't stop Li Si, now prime minister, from covering up his death. He hid the deceased emperor in a cart full of dead fish. This, of course, masked the smell of the body. Here's where things get really interesting. Chao Gao was the emperor's chief eunuch. He was responsible for the emperor's communications on the outside, which is why he had no problem getting his hands dirty to cover up Qin Shi Huang's death. It is also important to point out that the emperor's oldest son was in exile on the northern frontier because he was against the book burning of Minister Li Si. Apparently before the emperor died, he sent a sealed letter to his oldest son, Fu Su. The letter supposedly contained his last wishes, most likely naming his son as the next heir to the throne. Minister Li Si feared the prince being crowned emperor, as his previous quarrel has now set himself up to being stripped of his high position or even killed. That is why Minister Li Si and Chao Gao took over the government by force and conspired against the prince. Both Li Si and Chao faked a letter ordering the prince and his companion Meng Tian, a famous Qin state general, to commit suicide. The prince was fooled by the forged letter and did so as ordered. Next, Li and Chao forged a decree to make Qin Shi Huang's son and student to Chao Gao, Hu Hei, the second emperor of China. As emperor, he was known as Qin Urshi, which meant second generation of Qin. He was just 21 years old when he made it to the throne in 210 BC. The emperor was pretty much useless and desperately relied on Chao Gao. But of course, this is what Chao wanted. The emperor was a puppet. With Chao's puppet emperor, he silenced his opposition, which included ministers, generals, and even the emperor's own relatives, because all were a threat to his plans. Even Li Si, he clashed with Chao and was soon executed. Under Qin Urshi's terrible rule, revolts broke out across the nation. One of the attempts was the 209 BC Dacian Uprising, with many more revolts soon to come, as bandits and brigades grew in number. 2 years later, on September 207 BC, Chao Gao found a way to test his power. He offered a deer to the emperor, but claimed it was a horse. The emperor thought it was a joke, but soon realized that there were some agreeing of Chao. The people that called the deer a deer were executed by Chao. Although the Qin were able to stop most of the revolts, it still greatly reduced the Qin's manpower and supplies. Of course, the emperor was oblivious to what was happening outside his palace, as he was manipulated and lied to by Chao. In the Battle of Julu, the Qin were finally defeated. Around 300,000 men were lost, and the emperor didn't take the defeat seriously and thought the Qin had plenty of troops to spare. It wasn't until another eunuch loyal to the emperor told him the harsh truth of the battle and that Chao Gao was the man responsible for manipulating him. Unfortunately, the emperor discovered the truth a bit too late, as Chao knew the emperor would find out eventually, so he surrounded the emperor with his loyal troops and executed him. Qin Urshi was emperor for 3 years and was executed at the age of 24. After his death, the second emperor was condemned by Chao and denied a royal burial. He was buried in modern-day Qian. This tomb was less elaborate than his father's, and he had no terracotta army to defend him in the afterlife. After Qin or Shi's death, Chao chose the third emperor, or should I say king, as the Qin state, under all of these revolts, lost their power over China. He was named Ziying. There was not much known about Ziying. It is mentioned in historical records that he was the son of the first emperor's eldest son, Fusu, but according to Professor Wang Li Qin, he was possibly one of the first emperor's brothers. Research from Li Li Kun and Ma Fi Bei have proposed that Ziying could be the son of the first emperor's half-brother, Chen Qiang. Whoever it is, we may never know. What is important is Ziying was the person on the Qin imperial court to defend and attempted to convince the second emperor against the executions of General Meng Tian and his younger brother Meng Yi. Ziying would soon lure Zhao Gao into a trap and assassinate him. This is in my opinion, but I think Ziying maybe saw through Zhao's deceptive nature, or maybe this was revenge for Fusu's execution from the forged letter by Zhao and Li Si. Getting rid of Chao would end up being pointless, as in the end, countless uprisings led to their surrender by Liu Bang in 206 BC in the capital of Chanyang. Liu Bang was a common peasant who turned into an outlaw. He accepted the Qin king's surrender, and the king was spared for only a short while. Another important figure was a man named Xiang Yu. He was seen as the leader of the revolt. Xiang Yu was an aristocrat from the kingdom of Chu. Out of the two men, Xiang Yu was a better military leader as he defeated the main armies of the Qin state, which allowed Liu Bang to take the weakened capital. Xiang Yu then decided to exterminate the imperial house of Qin, along with the king Ziying. This officially ended the Qin dynasty. After the fall of Qin, Xiang Yu made plans to split the empire into 19 kingdoms. He would be the king of Chu and would reign over the other 18 kingdoms. Liu Bang assumed he would be given the Qin state, but that was not the case, as Xiang Yu split Qin in three and gave each part to a former Qin general. Liu was then made the king of Han. Liu Bang was not happy with the deal and started a civil war against Xiang Yu, but other kings went to war with each other as well. This was known as the Chu Han contention and lasted from 206 to 202 BC. To sum it all up, Liu Bang, along with the Han, Wei, Qi, and other rebel armies, surrounded Xiang Yu at Gixia. Liu Bang even managed to convince Xiang Yu's commander-in-chief to betray him. Xiang Yu was overwhelmed, but managed to escape. He was then hunted down, and then when cornered, he killed himself. Xiang Yu's death ended the idea of a Chu dynasty. Xiang Yu's brother did make a weak attempt to continue fighting, but surrendered soon after. A few months after the war, Liu Bang became the first emperor of the Han dynasty. As you can see, the Qin dynasty only lasted for 15 years, but it did have a big influence on the other Chinese states. With standardization and great building projects such as roads, irrigation, and the Great Wall of China, the first emperor succeeded in creating a superpower. But at what cost? Sure, the first emperor controlled a powerful state with many accomplishments, but he still was a tyrant that suppressed his people under the tool of legalism, which ultimately became the dynasty's downfall as revolts and weak leadership destroyed the Qin dynasty for good. If there had to be a lesson to be learned from the Qin dynasty, it is there has to be a balance of leadership while equally pleasing your people, as a revolution will be on your hands if you don't. Thanks for watching. What are your thoughts on the Qin dynasty? Let me know in the comments section below. I know I haven't been making videos for a long period of time, and I'm going to give it another shot. For my next video, I'm thinking on one of three potential topics: exploring the Iranian salt mummies, a video on the ancient Amorites, or a look at Qin Shi Huang's royal tomb. If you liked the video, make sure to leave a like. It really helps me out. If you haven't already, subscribe for more history content, and I'll see you guys in the next video.